Hey, brothers and sisters, I hope you guys are doing all right. Praise be God, Most High, Creator of heaven and earth. Hallelujah. For He is, hallelujah, the first and the last, the beginning and the end, the Alpha and Omega. Hallelujah, the fairest of 10,000, the lily of the valley, the rose of Sharon. Hallelujah, He is God Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Hallelujah, praise His holy name. Hallowed be His holy name. His will be done, His kingdom come. In us as it is in heaven. Hallelujah. Praise God, brothers and sisters. Hope you guys are doing all right. I hope that, you've been trying to get under the spot where the glory comes out. Hallelujah. That the windows of heaven will be open above you. Hallelujah. That you be the head and not the tail. Be the first and not the last. Be blessed going in and blessed coming out. Blessing the city and blessing the country. Hallelujah. Thank God Almighty, through whom all blessings flow. For His word says we've been redeemed from the curse of the law, but not the blessings, brothers and sisters. We are not redeemed from the blessings. Hallelujah. As I've been quoting from the blessings that you can find them as an example in Deuteronomy. As Moses tells the children of Israel, if you're obedient and you follow the law, then God was going to bless you. And if you don't follow the law, you're going to be cursed. You'll be cursed in the city and cursed in the country. Cursed going in and cursed coming out. You'll be all of those things. But it says in the New Testament, thanks be to God that we've been redeemed from the curse of the law. Brothers and sisters, it's by the blood. Hallelujah. The curse came from God. Brothers and sisters, it tells us in Genesis, when Eve ate the fruit and then Adam ate the fruit, God cursed the serpent. He cursed Eve. He said that you'll have pain in childbearing. And He said that your desire will be to be the boss over your husband. But He's going to be the boss over you. That's part of the curse on a woman. And the curse on the man is that you will toil by the sweat of your brow. You'll be planting, but you'll have thorns and thistles. All of those things that we deal with. Nowadays people don't farm like they used to, in the last generation or two. My grandfather was a farmer. And on back, they were farmers, brothers and sisters. And up from the beginning of time until just recently, now in America, we've become, moving away in the industrialization. We've lost all those things, and that's a whole other topic, brothers and sisters. We've lost that connection to those things in the Bible about being a farmer and all that, like even Adam did. He had to work by the sweat of his brow and deal with the thorns and the thistles and all that. But those are the curses, brothers and sisters. Those are the curses that God put on mankind. He even cursed the earth, said that, the thorns and thistles would come out of it. That there was death on the earth. God Himself was the first one to kill anything in the garden. He killed animals and made a skin, to cover the nakedness of Adam and Eve. And so death began to rule and reign on earth because of the curses that God, the curse that God had put on all things because of the fall of man, brothers and sisters. And then along came the law of Moses that laid out all of these laws. Before that, there was only the one law. Don't eat the fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And then God gave Noah other rules. And then on to the law of Moses where God, from Abraham, God began to deal with one man and his descendants, his seed. God told Adam, Abraham that all the world will be blessed through your seed. Singular, as Paul tells us in Romans chapter 4. That seed, of course, is the seed of the woman where God promised to Eve when He cursed her and cursed the serpent and cursed Adam. And He said that your seed, the seed of the woman, will crush the head of the serpent. He'll bruise his heel. The Messiah bruised his heel on that cross, brothers and sisters, I've talked about in the past. He crushed the serpent that day, brothers and sisters. So the law of Moses, to go back to that, the law of Moses brought us the knowledge of sin and death. The New Testament tells us that the law is a schoolmaster or a nanny. They say now in the modern discoveries they've had of ancient language, in modern day language, they've determined that the word is better stated as nanny than schoolmaster. So say those scholars who research these things in the Greek language. The law is a schoolmaster or a nanny that brings us to the knowledge of sin and death. But by the law that we knew we violated God's holy perfect standard. Without the law, we wouldn't know what God's perfect standard is, brothers and sisters. So we can see by the law that God gave to Moses. In other words, if I drove down the road and there's no speed limit, I can drive any speed I want. And I don't even think, oh, well, it's dangerous to drive 100 miles an hour. Before, you, if you were ignorant of that, you didn't know that. Hey, you're just driving all you want. Then you see a sign, oh, it's 35 miles an hour in America, or say 50 kilometers an hour in most places in the world, a citywide speed limit. You see a sign, oh, okay, there is a rule. I didn't even know I was speeding until I saw that sign. Whoa, I thought the speed limit was unlimited, or I thought it was 100 kilometers an hour, 55 miles an hour, what, 60 miles an hour. No, I found out that there's a speed limit of 35. Whoa, I'm in violation of that. I'm in violation of that standard. I've broken the law. As the Bible says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There is none perfect, none righteous, no, not one. The Bible tells us, that it's the gift of God through Jesus Christ, that we have eternal life, brothers and sisters. It says, the text I'm quoting, the wages of sin is death. Where did we hear that? God said that to Adam and told Adam. When the day you eat that fruit, you'll truly die. You know those atheist brothers and sisters with their ignorant means not knowing something. You know, stupid is when you don't have the ability to learn. When you use the word ignorant, it's the proper term to use if you don't know better than something. That's ignorant. Not necessarily an insult, but it can be taken as an insult. That's awesome too. I don't really care. Because the Bible says the fool has said in his heart there is no God. So God calls someone that doesn't believe in God a fool. So, ignorance is a whole lot lighter than fool. But anyway, brothers and sisters, when we are ignorant of these things, of God, of course, then, we don't know what we're doing, brothers and sisters. That's why God gives us his grace, brothers and sisters, to become born again. Give our lives to the Lord and be redeemed from the curse of the law, brothers and sisters. So the law brings us to the knowledge of sin and death. That way we know that, hey, we've fallen short of God's perfect standard. We've fallen short of his glory. We have not met God's perfect holy standard. That's where we all are, brothers and sisters. So what I was trying to get at is to tell you, brothers and sisters, that we must be redeemed. We must be redeemed by the blood of that seed of the woman, the blood of Yeshua, Jesus the Messiah, Jesus the Christ. He's our Savior. He's our Deliverer. He died in our place. The Bible says he became sin for us. He took upon himself our sicknesses and carried our infirmities. He took upon himself all of the burden of the wrath of God abided on Christ. It says he became our propitiation in the King James. He became the mediator. He's the mediator. The Bible says there is one mediator between God and man, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the one mediator. Oh yeah, now I remember the point I was going to make. Brothers and sisters, let me go back, because I don't use notes. I said that there are people who are atheists and all this stuff, and people that are agnostics, and they'll sit there and say, inconsistencies in the Bible. That's what I wanted to mention, that, as I just touched on. God told Adam, the day you eat the fruit, you'll surely die. So, people who are ignorant of understanding the Bible, that's the problem with people who just got saved yesterday trying to read Revelation. You got to understand the whole Bible before you just flip open the Bible. Oh, 104, only 144,000 are going to heaven. I've heard that from my drunk, drug addict, alcoholic relatives who refuse to get saved, want to live for the devil, and they say, well, only 144,000 is going to heaven anyway. They flip open their Bible while they're high or drunk, start reading some kind of scripture without knowing them. It's nonsense, and they know it's nonsense. But anyway, the Bible says, God told Adam, the day you eat the fruit, you surely die. So people sit there and say that's a contradiction. It's a contradiction because Adam didn't die that day. But brothers and sisters, the Bible says, with God, 1,000 years is as but a day, and a day is but as 1,000 years. So with God, God counts one day as 1,000 years in our years, brothers and sisters. That's why I talk about the 7 days. On the seventh day, the Lord God rested, and then we see that on the seventh day is the millennial reign of Christ, 1,000-year reign of Christ. It's known as the day of the Lord. That's why all these people trying to divide about the rapture and all that stuff. And they'll start saying, you know, the day of the Lord. They'll use that to say that the rapture happens on the day of the Lord. On the day of the Lord, Jesus returns, there's a rapture. People get caught up to meet the Lord and then come back with him on the exact same day. And then the Lord will judge the sheep and the goats. How he's judging the sheep and the goats, if the sheep just went with him, they've already been judged if they were caught up. And that's a whole other, you know, argument about to prove the pre-tribulation rapture is 7 years before the return of Jesus. But the day of the Lord refers to the millennial reign of Christ. And even really the 7 year tribulation and the 1,000 year reign of Christ, that's really the day of the Lord. That time period. It's not a single day in our time. Another example of complete and utter ignorance of people who refuse to accept what the Bible clearly teaches, that the rapture, the pre-tribulation rapture, is a real event. But brothers and sisters, Adam lived less than 1,000 years. As a matter of fact, I believe he lived 935 years, maybe. The longest living man was Methuselah, 969 years. So no person has lived more than 1,000 years. That's why you see, you know, God knows everything. God is always perfect in all of his ways. That's why you don't see any human living more than 1,000 years. Because they all die in that one day in God's timing. That's why you see, as I said, Methuselah is 969. That's the oldest living person recorded in the Bible, Methuselah. So we see him dying. As a matter of fact, if I remember correctly, it's been a long time since I studied it, Methuselah died the same year that the flood came. You know, back when I was going to Bible school, when I first started, before I started my going to a university, I took a Bible survey. I took a survey course of the whole Bible. And I got this big old giant atlas book of the, you know, timeline of the Bible. And I began to research that thing because I started as I read Genesis and really began to study Genesis before I even went to the Bible, university to study, to get my degree in the theology stuff. I began to say, well, you know, these patriarchs lived to be so old. Does this jibe with the dates about the flood and all that? Because they're living 900 some years. And, you know, how could none of that, if any of them were alive, they would have been killed in the flood. As I began to study, it came out that Methuselah died. And when Methuselah died, the flood came. And his name, and I don't remember off the top of my bat, but, you know, his name and, of course, Noah's name, all those names are prophetic. And I know that there's a study that each of those names of those original people lined up, gives the gospel. That's also another thing. If you take the meaning of each of their name together, it gives us the gospel. But, you know, Noah's name has a meaning that talks about, you know, the flood. And then Methuselah, his name has, you know, that at the end of his life, will be the flood. Basically, there's the meaning of their names. The Lord has everything perfect, just the way it needs to be, brothers and sisters. And I wasn't planning on talking about that, and it's been years since I looked at that stuff. So God bless you guys. I haven't been on here making a video in about a week, maybe. Been busy. Had a lot of things going on in my family. Been going along with that, brothers and sisters, and studying the Word of God and waiting on the Lord. The Lord is opening doors for me to do ministry work in Florida, and it looks like also in L.A., which would not be a place that would be on the top of my list to pick to do ministry work, but it's all in the Lord's will and all in the Lord's timing, brothers and sisters. So I'm just been waiting on the Lord and doing the work that the Lord would have me do, ministering to many of you guys through, you know, private messaging and talking with many of you guys. So praise God for that, for the opportunity to minister to many of you guys. God bless you. Still getting praise reports every day. Praise God from the anointing oil that we made. As the Lord led us to make the anointing oil and send it out, we get praise reports every day of healings, blessings. Praise God. It's a point of contact for our faith, brothers and sisters. And many praise reports from of people who are enjoying and passed out copies of the book that the Lord gave me to write. Been a huge blessing too. So praise the Lord for all those things. God is continuing to bless the Joshua's ministry. I'm just waiting on I'm doing kind of an admin thing here on the video. I'm just waiting on the time when the Lord would have me go to the Philippines. We basically have all the money we need almost. We're just a little bit short to buy the land. We're probably like $1,500 to $2,000 short on buying the land in the Philippines and starting the third orphanage. Praise God for that. You know, I want to give the Lord praise for that. Also, I already made a little short video. We're looking for somebody, someone who would help us with the website for Church Firstborn, someone that does computer programming and things like that, so we can get the website for the virtual church that the Lord told me to make, get it up running, Brother Sid and myself, and the Lord, you know, bring it to fullness of what God wants it to do. If you are involved in computer programming, you have these kind of ideas about, you know, doing the website to make it work. I don't know if anybody's really doing a virtual church. And so we need wisdom from God on exactly how we need to make that go so it's functioning the way that the church wants it to function. So praise God for that. And I ask you to keep that in your prayers. All the things I mentioned, keep it in your prayers, please, brothers and sisters, for the ministry, for the orphanages, as we would expand the orphanage. I'm looking at adding more orphanages, orphans, to the two orphanages we have. And we're still ever praying to increase the feedings, brothers and sisters. We feed 800 plus kids every week, street kids, and teach them Bible. You know, like it's like a vacation Bible school. You know, we teach them the songs, you know, Jesus Loves Me and things like that. And then we read the books. Someone had donated some Christian books for children, storybooks, picture books that we show the children all over the place about the Lord and all of those things from the Bible. And I ask you guys to pray about that too, that you know, that we can continue to expand. I'd like to, you know, feed, you know, make go feed more than 1,000 every week if we have the budget. Praise God, we do it. 2,000, whatever the Lord wants, we want to do it. We want to always ever, you know, set the goal higher, to do more for the Lord. We can never do enough, you know. And you know, I always think about that movie Schindler's List. If you haven't seen that, it's an awesome movie. I'll say awesome. It's an excellent movie to see. It's not really awesome, of course. It's a sad, true story. But at the end of the movie, you know, old Oscar Schindler, he says, you know, I could have done more. You know, and I think that, you know, that's how I feel. When the rapture happens, when we're there with the Lord, I could say, well, you know, we could have done more. We could have had more orphans. We could have helped more orphans. We could have built more orphanages. We could have, you know, fed more kids and told more people about the Lord. You know, evangelize more people. So, of course, there's never enough. Brothers and sisters, that's the beauty of the ministry. Lots of you guys, you know, you work and all the time and you don't have time to go to the Philippines and things like that. You don't have time to, you don't have the calling or the, you know, the anointing to make videos on YouTube. You don't have that, that's not what God called you to do. But praise God, many people have been called to support orphanages. You know, so, you know, when we get to heaven, we all will get rewarded and credited from the Lord and you know, and credited and blessed and the Lord will say, you know, well done, that you contributed to help, you know, you're part of Joshua's ministry. You contributed for the weekly feedings. You've contributed to help build the orphanages. You know, your reward is, as the Jesus said, you know, those who give a cup of, you know, give a you know, whatever it is, give a cup of water to a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. You know, so when we give to any ministry, I give to ministries too, brothers and sisters. I give myself out of my own money, you know, to other people. So I'm participating with them. I'm part of that, part of their, you know, I'm in with them in their rewards and their blessings. And I'm, you know, with them in the ministry whenever we help, either by, you know, intercessory prayer, donations, physically, literally going and doing it, just like we have people in the Philippines who are literally cooking the food and feeding the kids. And then there are people who are reading the storybook and then singing the songs with the kids and telling them about Jesus and all that. And then, you know, I'm administrating that. So we're all, and the people that donate, we're all in that together, brothers and sisters. We're all part of that. We're all part of it. Anyone who participates in any ministry, anything in the name of the Lord for the Lord, we're all part of that. And the Lord sees all that and we're blessed for that. Lord rewards us and blesses us in this life and the life to come, he said. So praise God for that, brothers and sisters. I just want to encourage you, you know, to do all you can for the Lord. Be all you can for the Lord because he's redeemed us from the curse of the law. Praise God for that. Anyway, I just want to make a video because I haven't made one in several days. And praise God, the Lord has many things he's been showing me. I got to study it out and pray about it before I make the videos. But, you know, praise God for all that he's doing. And I know when people are still running to and fro trying to calculate the day of the rapture, and I pray for all those who, you know, who have already gone back to sleep because the rapture didn't happen when somebody had calculated it on YouTube and it didn't happen. And then people were hurt by that. And I pray that, that, of course, you don't put your faith in dates. We put our faith in the Lord. And we put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and the steadfast love of the Lord. You know, as I've sang that song many times, the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. It's from the Bible, you know. And then there's a song. For His mercies are new every morning. New every morning. Great is Thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is Thy faithfulness. He is faithful and just God and a faithful God. And He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. Praise God. Seek the Lord while He may be found. Put your faith, hope, and trust in the Lord. For He is worthy of all praise, brothers and sisters. Praise God for the Lord God Almighty. Hallelujah. Bless His holy name. Just praise the Lord today. For the Bible says, you know, the Spirit of the Lord is in the praises of Israel, it says in the Bible. So, you know, we as the church, of course, His Spirit, the Lord inhabits and dwells in our praises too, of course, we the church. Praise God, brothers and sisters, for the Spirit of the living God. Hallelujah. God bless you guys. May the Lord be with you always. In Jesus' name.